So I think it's just been a very, very interesting set of conversations that we are having. Just wanted to do a special thanks to a very important person from my point of view, in terms of like the kind of influence he has created in India and the way he has supported our effort. In fact, the gentleman is standing here on my left. In fact, Anil Chalamalasetty, I think this whole event has been really brought out in terms of with his support. He's been just one of the most phenomenal supports for us. The whole idea on sustainability, as we were really talking about, how India can change, is something that we are really bringing out here in the conference as well. Anil is somebody who's a first-generation entrepreneur. He's created this enterprise called Greenko. In fact, a lot of you will not be knowing. In fact, out of those 167 billionaires that somebody was talking about, here is one on my left. So he is possibly part of the Gilded Age, if you might want to say, but somebody who has a great heart, a very kind man, and I think you will always get amazed by his simplicity. In fact, the first time when I met him about a few years back, I was absolutely floored by, there is this absolutely a person walking on just one of the buildings and he's talking to everybody and he's just trying to learn and he's trying to make things. He's somebody who's made a difference to the whole cause in India of green energy. But at this occasion, I would also like to suggest share that we are coming out with two working papers immediately after the conference wherein we are talking about ZEVs and we are also talking about PLI and its impact on zero emissions. So that is what we are doing, but special thanks to Anil once again for supporting and being here and sharing your views on new India and new energy. So looking forward to this interaction. Over to you, Anil.
Please. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, Amitabh ji and distinguished guests from India and Stanford, very good morning. Thanks to I'm very pleased to be presenting this new energy and new India opportunity towards and to share my thoughts and share my views around what we've been. I think yesterday we had a very good sessions from hearing from Arun Mujumdar and Mr. Amitabh ji about what actually in the climate change impacts and how India has been tackling towards and on macro level. I just want to deep dive in my own experience with two. Companies which are founded and operating. One is a Greenko, which is an electron company. How we actually where we make an carbon-free electrons towards an decarbonizing the discoms or distribution companies or industrialization. Other companies being AM Green, which is a molecule company. With this, both the companies we're trying to address towards a larger opportunity, which is being presented towards us. We're going to see. I think the global warming and 1.5 degrees of the impact. I think it's. Most of the world believes it. Some part of the world still doesn't agree about it. But whoever believes and whoever trying to act upon it, it's very important for them to act at an urgency to safeguard our next generation. It's not actually it's for us. It's for basically stewards and taking care of the. I think there are a lot of statements which have been given. The world will live. It's all actually it's for us towards our mankind. Towards how do we humankind and. Be sustained towards the next generation to have healthier lives. I think this all the stats have been well known, being an intellectual here, and how do you address those things is a genuine opportunity what we're trying to take. I think this whole journey, I think we've been very proud towards how the government of India, under the leadership of Modi ji, and how we've been proactively been leading these things with an RV Invest 2015, which actually unlocked the whole RE opportunity in India. How we initially put up a target to saying that by 2022, we had to do 200 gigawatts. And as soon as we achieved that, we put up a benchmark towards 500 gigawatts by 2030. The incredible policies and push, which actually enabled towards India, towards journeying towards the opportunities. And with macro drivers, yes, there are a lot of corporates which have been driving to drive towards NM. How they've been participating, how we have a financial investors who are trying to say how they're driving towards and large corporates to do make investments in a decarbonized manner, while we have actually consumers, which actually has been driving those things. How do you bridge them towards achieving those things? The great opportunity for an to do a reindustrialization in a decarbonized manner. going to see macro picture, while we are seeing the energy basket, though it's been carbonizing with the 30% levels, but if you're going to see the impact of it at the macro level, and then, while the global economy is $100 trillion per annum, of that, purely energy market itself is $13 trillion. In that, while LCD says it's been consuming at an 30% of the carbonization, this contribution is only 21%. While we have 80% of other markets, other sector, which is being in carbonizing the whole economies, global environment, ecosystem. In the same relative manner, if you're going to see as India's energy basket is close to $250 billion. Out of that, less than 20% is power market, which is $40 billion. In that, renewables is $6 billion. While we have been trying to see that renewables has been an opportunity to do and decarbonizing the whole power sector, it's a great opportunity. How do we convert the electrons towards molecules and impact towards the other larger market? There's a great energy opportunity where we would say energy as a transitioning. If you want to see like in, from 1970s to 60s, how the telecoms has been transferred towards the data and today digital worlds. We clearly see that there's an opportunity in energy transitioning, where the electrons can be converting into the molecules, which are going to displacing towards an, which could be displacing towards most of the commodities what can be used. In the macro picture, you can see India, though India is going to be third largest consumer, the per capita of an Indian's energy consumption is probably one third of the global average, or developed economy's average. I just want to give it. And while India is the fastest energy consuming country, while we have in close to 10% energy growth compared to anywhere else, when on year on year, post COVID, which I think last five quarters, we have seen close to 8.5 to 11.5% of the energy demand been increasing. It can be because of the energy for all, accessibility, and social demographics being growing. They keep on demanding towards more energy. So the great opportunity in India is, how do we actually have a new energy in a decarbonized manner? How do we have a new economy in a decarbonized manner? There's a great drive and push, which actually government of India as well been driving towards it. I would say, while India has been digitized actually in most of this policy makings or a UPI in the digital economy manner, interestingly, from without realizing from last 20 years onwards, India has been consistently investing a lot of capital and as well in policy and regulations to make sure we could able to achieve one nation, one grid, one frequency. And that's a phenomenal positioning of India compared to anywhere else in the world. Either it can be larger economies, it can be European economies, it can be US, it can be China. The biggest differentiator for India is how India's energy transition can be in global, take it to its in global leadership. Either it can be in India being one nation, one grid, we have a renewables right from the north of India with the Himalayan hydros, within Deccan plateaus and semi-arid lands of solar, and huge coastal lands, coastal paths, and peninsula of wind, which integrates the whole renewables in India as one nation. It enables us towards an integrating energy one location and drawing energy from anywhere else in the country. And with the combination of a mineral rich in India and having a renewable energy around the clock availability, that makes India a very, very superior opportunity to make it as a green product exporter for the world. And given this, understanding the opportunity and the needs of then how the infrastructure need to be developed, policies need to be developed, and how Indian companies can place to be in the global marketplace. The government of India has been consistently been developing in infrastructure and policy making. I'll be proud to say that as an AM Green, we have signed India's first energy export contract, converting the solar and wind into a green hydrogen and exporting towards the European markets, our OECD markets, and again cracking back the ammonia and delivering the hydrogen then and consumptions, where they're going to be used in the in their energy systems. While we've been importing over $110 billion of oil and gas $10 to $20 billion. I clearly see an opportunity by 2030. India would be exporting pure solar and wind over $10 billion by 2030. I would say that's a great position change, shift change. But within 40, 50, I think we could be able to say that we could be net exporter and importer. That's a great opportunity what I would be able to position that. Given that level of policy making, infrastructure, and what we have, and there's a huge shift what is enabling towards and how we could be able to deliver towards and the digital capability, renewables, and global infrastructure, how we are getting connected towards the global economies, the great path to go forward. As I mentioned earlier, this is actually how I was mentioning about telecom to digitalization of the global economy. This is a great energy transitioning, how the traditional hydrocarbons, which have been going to refineries, making in various chemicals, energy, or whatever use cases. Today, we have a great opportunity to converting towards wind, solar, and biomass into the products which can be delivered towards the same use cases, which have never been done. And that's why I was saying that where in the $13 trillion of an energy basket of a global economy, we have a $2 trillion as an power. In that, less than, say, $200 billion is in renewables. Today, that we have an opportunity, we are converting these electrons towards looking at an opportunity of $11 trillion of opportunity. So it's not only just for India. I would say this is a great opportunity for a whole global South, how they can participate in the global economies. Otherwise, the $13 trillion market was only been addressed by OPEC countries, oil-producing countries, which are 13 to 20 countries. But given this opportunity of an energy transitioning and the technology which are enabling towards converting the electrons towards the molecules are giving access towards a global South, like it can be in African countries, it can be Southern and South Asian countries, that's a great opportunity how they can participate in the global economies. The simple process, how it can be converted into the larger markets. The various products, what can be developed in various technology which are right now available. As something was mentioning about a green premium, I would say there, yes, today probably 10-20% in some of the products what we've been doing here, but it's important for the existence of the whole, understand the climate challenges. It's important to have this initiative, the process. Probably in less than a decade, we would be able to see that we'll get a green discount than a green premium. It's a good initiative, but how actually in a decade long, how things have been moving from where to where, and while the electrons have been coming at the lowest cost, and the industrialization can be globalized and decentralized, rather than where it used to be the whole markets have been centralized towards and where the products have been produced. They can be well distributed as of now. This India's opportunity where we import close to $42 billion of an LNG just to use the hydrogen in refineries and ammonia or fertilizers. Today, with our own domestic consumption, we could displace that. Out of $120 billion of oil and gas imports, we can immediately displace that $40 billion of imports of LNG to using a green hydrogen, displacing the existing refineries and fertilizer markets. It's very interesting to see how we can able to look at while we're looking at the carbon-free industrialization, carbon-free distribution of energy across the world and the raw materials, it's a great opportunity to see how we can do carbon-free data. With the AS and if you want to see in the last 20 years, US energy growth was less than 1%. Having 1.3 terawatts of capacity. In the last 2 years, after the ChatGPT data centers and rapid OTT development, we're seeing over 2 to 2.5% of an energy demand being added up towards an American grid system, which is equivalent towards 30 gigawatts of round-the-clock power, firm power, which demands towards how the data has been demanding towards more energy to be consumed, how the data centers can be made into a more carbon-free green data. The broader architecture, which we have been classified towards, and how do we accelerate various feedstocks with a scope 1, scope 2, scope 3, where actually input materials, how actually feedstock materials, how they do disperse towards this. And today we have been solutions towards in every value chain of the business. It's all that, how do we adapt and when do we adapt? How do we push the markets towards this? How do we actually participate towards and how do we make them the collaborative and cooperatively make everybody integrate towards in our whole value chain where we exist? I think I just had a video just to show what we've been doing at the corporate level. We have been we had a very humble start with the 3 biomass plants of 21 megawatts back in 15 years back. I lived in London, moved back along with a friend, Mahesh Kohli. We both founded the company, these two companies. We were extremely lucky to be in this generation and the change generation, and having an taking advantage of the India's policy making and support what we had, that gave a great confidence and evolved ourselves towards 10 gigawatts of operation. Though it's 7.5, we'll be 10 gigawatts of operation this year. And we actually unlocked a very interesting energy storage thought process, which we had been in 100 years old technology of in hydro pump storage. We are building in 100 gigawatt hours of a hydro storage platform and making it digital. India being one nation, one grid, we are building in storage networks across the country, building, setting, integrating them to the central CTU. On top of that, we are building a digital platform, making it in a cloud storage system. So that any renewable energy producer can dynamically, digitally store his energy and draw back energy whenever he wants, either any energy consumer. This is the first project which we're going to commission next quarter, which is there for 680 megawatts of 6 hours of storage, which can be used twice a day, which are 10 gigawatt hours, can be used twice. And that's been integrated within 4,000 megawatts of solar and 1,000 megawatts of wind. So this particular project can serve multiple use cases, which it can be giving an round-the-clock power towards an hard-to-abate industries like steel and cement plants. We have been tied up with an ArcelorMittal. We are helping them towards decarbonize their plant in Gujarat, while this plant is in the south in Andhra, which is in India, south of India. And while this same asset is helping towards in some states with the peak power demands and serving towards an, my other company will be using the same asset to produce a round-the-clock power to create a green hydrogen and packing the hydrogen with the nitrogen to from atmosphere and making ammonia and export to the global markets. India being not having access towards the gas and the oil for the energy basket from historically, we always been suffered to having a flexibility in the grid systems. Today, with this storage as the ability, we are unlike anywhere else in the world, we have a flexible power or peak power to address at lowest cost, otherwise than anywhere in the world. Otherwise, most part of the world, we have a peak power being addressed with the most expensive in the whole basket of energy. Thanks for giving the opportunity. Thanks, Amit. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.